has a hard on.
Perfect world is a dream. Primitive.
Fucking asshole. He's a tight ass. He's a sadist.
You're all going to die down here.
The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist.
Happy heresies, my beloved true seekers, my lovers of wisdom, my mystic free thinkers and enthusiastic myth makers. You are entering Coffee, Cigarettes, and Gnosis, a district of the virtual Alexandria, that sanctuary beyond the lullaby of the angelic mafia, where all that is imagined can become proven.
I'd rather roast an L.
And lastly, where we hope Hypatia makes it home this time, escaping the Christian mob like Sophia escaped the evil angels in the Simonian cosmogony. Run, Lola's, run. Here we get acquainted with the Gnostics and their brethren in the Esoterica, which is in essence are your story and the story of your slow burn ascent into the Pleroma. Plato said all learning is remembering, and here we remember that we are gods in the becoming and aliens in an alien world of shadow and tear.
What if this is as good as it gets?
Or to summarize it better, I quote from the English poet, Alfred Edward Houseman, who wrote, "I, a stranger and afraid in a world I never made." That is our plight, my beloved true seekers, and thus we emanate ourselves somewhere in the mid to early December 2007 to gradually climb out of the matrix and slowly into the light. I am Abraxas in his mortal incarnation of Miguel Connor, somewhere in the wintry hell of Chicago.
Did you lose your mind all of a sudden, or was it a slow, gradual process?
For you newbies recently arrived to our shores from the eternal floods of the Demiurge, who cannot stand any of the Nephilim, our spiritual ancestors, please take a safari through our website, thegodabovegod.com, or our MySpace profile, myspace.com/thegodabovegod. You'll certainly find a deeper reality than that offered by our extroverted, dogmatic society that is nothing but a gilded cage.
I believe that as a species, human beings define their reality through misery and suffering.
Our guest today is here to discuss his inspiring new book, Living Gnosticism. Jordan Stratford certainly brings perhaps the most important keystone besides Gnosis about the reality of those who call themselves the Gnostics. And what is that? Well, think of the title of his book and how it's easier said than done. We are the Gnostics, right? Or are we truly putting our spiritual money where our theological mouth is? We'll get to this question shortly.
Just awe-inspiring stuff.
Jordan visits the virtual Alexandria a third and charming time, discussing, as I mentioned before, an awfully vital detail facing everyone who has taken residence in the Gnostic halls of the palaces of the Esoterica. So you've seen those pamphlets that say, "So you've gotten pregnant. So you've contracted AIDS," or "So you've bought into the global warming chimera," and so forth. But where is the pamphlet that says, "So you've learned Gnosticism, now what?" Well, there isn't one unless you buy into the New Age insulin of such false Gnostics like Sylvia Brown.
Were you going to plagiarize the whole thing for us? Do you have any thoughts of your own on this matter?
What we really have, from the Gospel of Thomas to Philip K. Dick's Valis, is the visionary experiences of Gnostic saints. There are clues, from their lives and their ethereal odysseys, on how to incorporate the skeletal structure of Gnosticism into the jelly of mere existence.
Go ahead and run! Run home and cry to mama!
But it's not easy to find, because Gnosticism is a hard mitzvah to get your little tyrant ego around because of the little tyrant ego itself. That's why it will always be the minority of the minority faiths. Outside of the Gospel of Philip, also known as the Sacramental Gospel, some of the Valentinian liturgy, and a handful of tractates from the Nag Hammadi Library, there are a few Gnostic texts that reveal the maps of Gnosis or even the Gnostic attitude in full practice. And even when these gems are found in bodies of work censored and mutilated by centuries of Orthodox fury, the question is whether the ancient praxis of the Gnostics can truly fit in a postmodern world of extroverted cancer.
We've all been raised on television to believe that one day we'd all be millionaires and movie gods and rock stars, but we won't. We're slowly learning that fact. very, very pissed off.
The answer is, like much of Gnosticism, yes and no. Like I've written before, Gnosis is not a one-size-fits-all launching pod to the transcendent. You, as a being of spirit, psyche, and flesh, have been given a different taste for the celestial menu and a different diagram to return to the Pleroma.
You're all individuals!
Yes, we're all individuals!
In the same relation, your living Gnosticism will be different than other individuals. C.G. Jung lived the conservative life of a stoic Swiss gentleman. Philip K. Dick roared through the life as a West Coast child of a drug culture. Carlos Castaneda hung out with a shaman. Joseph Campbell tasted enlightenment by just underlining books. Alan Moore immerses himself in the myth-making of a workaholic writer, while the Wachowski brothers dress in drag and engross themselves in the Hollywood hurricanes while making their movies.
Your destiny lies along a different path from mine.
And it was just as varied in the early days of Gnosticism. Simon Magus wandered the land with Helen of Troy, preaching his greatness in the news that the God spark was in everyone. Valentinus and Basilides were ensconced in their philosophical schools and carried silver spoons around their necks. Marcus the Magician terrorized Bishop Irenaeus, seduced French gals, and wove mystical poetry to the masses. The prophet Mani and Marcion of Sinope lived the life of monks, and were in fact monks for all practical purposes. And let's not even get to the various Gnostic sects and their rainbow of lifestyle choices. So, am I basically confusing you? No, because the CCG philosophy still stands strong. You must write your own gospel and live your own myth. Time will test you, and so will the powers and principalities. What is left afterwards is what is true. You are the spiritual descendants of Seth, the first mortal Gnostic, but your path is a unique comet once you are honest with yourself and your destiny.
There is no price for individuality.
There won't be a checklist to make sure you're living Gnosticism. You'll just know, and the awakened ones around you will know as well. And in the end, you just won't care. And in the farthest end, where the firewalls of time and space fade against the astral fire of dream and imagination, your Gnosis is all that matters. But let's not forget that making the world a better place by spreading the light is a second great commission.
Neo, sooner or later you're going to realize, just as I did, there's a difference between knowing the path and walking the path.
Our guests and this forgotten god have talked in past shows about the various options of finding your own method to living Gnosticism. None that really includes studying them until you can beat everyone in a debate forum. But Jordan will further reveal that finger pointing to the moon. You must crane your spiritual neck to see the midnight sun of Isis. It began with you as a fragment of the divine. It ends with you recognizing that all you are is a fragment of the divine, trying to enter the delta that is Horus, the border to the Pleroma. The path of ascent is the same as the path of descent, as the secret book of John tells us. You gotta get in to get out, Peter Gabriel sang in the Carpet Crawlers.
If you do not know the present, how can you claim to know the future?
And despite how complicated Gnosticism seems to be, and living Gnosticism as well, all you have to do is be, as the Gospel of Thomas says, in movement and in rest. Be the Tao, and you'll find that it's much simpler than you'll ever imagine. Here is an example in the same Gospel of Thomas, saying number 25. Jesus said, "Love your friends like your own soul, protect them like the pupil of your eye." Or even better is what Jesus says in saying number 6. His disciples asked him and said to him, "Do you want us to fast? How should we pray? Should we give to charity? What diet should we observe?" Jesus said, "Don't lie and don't do what you hate, because all things are disclosed before heaven. After all, there is nothing hidden that will not be revealed, and there is nothing covered up that will remain undisclosed."
What we do in life echoes in eternity.
In other words, love like it's your last day on earth. Be authentic. Be honest but honorable. Be true to your nature and the nature of your divine self. Never forget where you came from and where you're going. And understand that you have already won the game of life because you no longer are attached to anything in life. Or something like that. Maybe that's not living Gnosticism. Maybe I'm Jehovah and you are my buffet dinner. Maybe everything I've said is a big fat lie. but I can assure you that Jordan Stratford is a real deal after you listen to the interview that approaches us like a springtide sunrise. This is the Coffee, Cigarettes, and Gnosis interview. With us today, we have Father Jordan Stratford discussing his new book, Living Gnosticism. A wonderful read. I highly recommend to all of you, and I've already mentioned that in the preface to the interview. How are you doing today, Jordan?
I'm great. Thanks, Miguel. How are you doing?
Oh, just wonderful. Like you, trying to survive the winter. So the question that probably goes through many people's minds, you know, you've read like pamphlets that say, so you're pregnant, what are you going to do now? Or so, but what do we do about the pamphlet that says, so it's the 21st century and we've studied Gnosticism. What's next? How do we live Gnosticism?
Well, I think that, I mean, the real interesting question is not so much how do we live Gnosticism, it's how do we live. And then what does Gnosticism bring to that discussion? I think that any aware person who is going to accept some kind of non-local connection with themselves, with the universe, with their society, with their community, is facing a lot of questions right now in terms of what our speciational, what our global responsibilities are, and then say, what does Gnosticism bring to that specific equation? And I think that obviously Gnosticism does have a few points to bring to the table. And the first one is really about understanding our place in this milieu in which we find ourselves, not just our place in evolution, our place in our own spiritual evolution, but our place within the models that we have created for ourselves, you know, that we inhabit a cosmos, we inhabit a set of systems and a set of assumptions, and for the most part, those systems are not in our best interest, and that Gnosticism has always had a set of tools to bring to this question, who are we and why are we here, and what's getting in the way? And we have this tremendous cultural repository for asking this question in a very deep way and ultimately coming to conclusions, although Gnosticism has never been so much about answers as it has been about the process of asking these questions.
And backing up a bit, what were the exact reasons behind you writing Living Gnosticism? What was your impetus?
Well, I have about a meter and a half of bookshelf space with books that could all be referred to as dead Gnosticism. as soon as the whole question comes up, and you know, anybody who sets their Google alerts to the word Gnosticism for a week is going to see the same repetitive theme over and over again, which says Gnosticism is something that happened in the second century. It was a bunch of elitists who believed that only having a secret knowledge, like a secret handshake, would lead to salvation and that everybody else was doomed, and that it was essentially anti-Semitic. They rejected the idea of God. They hated the world, and that pretty much by their own devices, these guys just sort of packed up and went home. And you'll see it through the story, everything from a popular press, you'll see it from academic journals, and you're certainly going to see a lot of it from religious bloggers. And the big issue, even though that we keep seeing this restated constantly, is that this particular paradigm and this approach to Gnosticism is simply not supported by the evidence. That when we look at Gnostic material from the stuff which I include in Gnostic criteria within the continuum, things like the Book of Sophia and even the Book of Enoch, these are pre-Christian. If we're going to look at the Nag Hammadi library, we're going to see things like Thunder Perfect Mind, which is clearly pre-Christian in origin. So we have to start off by saying this is not a Christian heresy. This is not a Christian phenomenon. This is not a second century phenomenon. This is something that we certainly see happening a couple of hundred years before the Christian era. Then what do the Gnostics have to say for themselves? What do the authors of these documents have to say about the world and the earth and their place in it? And they're not saying that trees and flowers and rocks and puppies are bad. and they're not saying that, that sex is evil. I mean, when we do have those kinds of conversations or those kinds of themes being touched upon, we're seeing, I think, a 2,000-year-old equivalent of an internet forum where a bunch of guys posit one idea and a bunch of other guys react to that, and they work out the math. Again, that bringing you back to this idea that it's more important about how we frame the question and how we engage with the question rather than coming up with some kind of definitive answer. I think I can sum that up by saying there's a lot of vitality within the Gnostic dialogue, and this tends to get overlooked when we talk about any kind of summation of Gnosticism, that we just focus on the dead guys. You know, there's, we say, Menander and Marcion and Simon Magus and Basilides and Bardesanes, and eventually we just have a bunch of dead Greek guys. And that's not really what Gnosticism is about. And when we fixate on that, as I think we have as a culture, as a community, as a scholarly community, that we end up negating the real richness and the vitality of the Gnostic conversation and its message.
Yeah, you give some great analogies in your book, Jordan. For example, you say that ancient Gnosticism is basically today's version of a cafe culture. Why do you say that?
Well, you know, again, it's not about issuing a press release or issuing an edict or a bull, although, you know, let's not kid ourselves, there's a lot of bull involved. It's a dialogue. You tend to have a specific frame set or subculture that's attracted to the Gnostic conversation in the first place. They tend to be artists and free thinkers and rabble rousers and shit disturbers and people who aren't afraid of, there's definitely a sense of humor. There's an iconoclasm. It takes a bit of daring, and sometimes it just takes a bit of punk ignorance to ask these questions in the first place. And when people start to creatively engage with the themes, with the core themes of Gnosticism, which hopefully we'll have a chance to explore in this conversation, there is definitely a kind of a beatnik vibe to the whole thing. So if you look at, for example, the Gospel of Philip, which I seem to have identified about five distinct voices within Philip. This is not one guy sitting down and writing this in an afternoon and sending it off to his publisher. This is clearly an amalgam of a whole bunch of different conversations, all of which are pseudo-epigraphically entitled the Gospel of Philip, that somebody redacted into a single document. And, we see a lot of these kinds of contradictions and noises, and at the end of the day, you're not looking at the Gospel of Philip the way that you would look at something like the Clementine letters or something by Aquinas. You're seeing a transcript of a dinner party. And, I think that the great richness that I find and the intellectual freedom that I find in contemporary Gnosticism is that it has maintained this dinner party atmosphere.
And Jordan, as well, you call Gnosticism, don't you call Gnosticism an airport religion?
Yeah, and I think that when we look at the authors of the original texts, everything from Thunder, Perfect Mind, and the Gospel of Thomas, that the specific regions, and predominantly Alexandria, at the second century before the Common Era, we're talking about Greek-educated, completely Hellenized, Greek-speaking Jews who wear Greek clothes and Greek hairstyles, coming from a Jewish background, living in ancient Egypt down the block from the Temple of Isis, at the doorstep, both geographically and historically, of the Roman Empire, even though it was the Republic at the time. Rome still had this tremendous imperium that it extended over trade and culture and travel and learning. There were these syncretizing poets and mythographers who had the treasure trove of all of Bronze Age Mediterranean culture from which to draw, and that's exactly what they did. They just put all this stuff into a blender and tried to make sense of it. And in some cases, these things are unfinished. Some of those questions are unresolved. So there's not any kind of monolithic Gnostic theology so much as there are a number of questions which keep getting asked and a number of tools with which to ask these questions.
And would you advise for the modern Gnostic to do just that, or like Philip K. Dick did, just put things in a blender and see what happens?
That's certainly a really good starting point.
Yeah, I agree.
I would say that regardless of whatever tradition that you're looking at, whether you're working with Orthodox Christianity or Judaism or Buddhism or Hinduism, is to look at the material that's extant, and it's a chemical or an alchemical reaction. You're putting this into your mind, your culture, your experience, your take on things, and seeing what kind of reactions emerge. So I don't think that Gnosticism is necessarily distinct in that sense, except that where you have had in a majority of world religions a canon, an orthodoxy, a specific ontology that's handed to you and said, okay, this is so, now how do you feel about it and to what degree are you going to conform to it? Gnosticism says, this is a conversation, here's some ideas, what do you got? So it's very inviting to that. So certainly the first step is dive in, look at these materials, try to get a sense of their context. What were the cultures and the specific languages being used during the authorship, the period of authorship of this material? And how does that sit with you? But don't stop there. Now go and create. Engage with it with your own vitality, with your own integrity, with your own cultural responsibility, with your own global responsibility. Engage with it as a lover, as a parent, as an artist, as a citizen, as a consumer, as a thinker, and reside with this stuff. And that's what I think has been missing from the majority of materials out there about Gnosticism, because it is based either in biblical archaeology or it's based in history and says, you know, once upon a time there are these crazy beatniks hanging out and on the Silk Road and borrowing ideas from everywhere. So this is why I say that, to create this analogy, the common or the contemporary model is the airport. That in an airport, nobody has arrived yet. Nobody flies from an airport to get to another airport. The airport is a means to an end. It's not the end itself. So if you're sitting in O'Hare or you're sitting in Vancouver Airport, people get off these planes from all over the world. You're hearing 100 languages in an hour. People come from their own experiences, their own cultures, with their own ideas and ideals, with their own models of how the universe works. And you're hearing all these little snippets of things. And then that experience, that buzz, is tremendously exciting and tremendously liberating because it opens all these possibilities. You can go from that airport to literally anywhere, to any idea or culture on the face of the earth. So the Silk Road definitely had that buzz and vibe. A modern airport has that buzz and vibe. And so Gnosticism is really about, as a contemporary religious culture, being open and accessible to these different voices and to these different ideas, and contributing to that buzz, contributing to that conversation.
In your book, you mention how you feel that waking up to the false reality modern Gnostics, a la Matrix, that many modern Gnostics embrace is not a path to enlightenment. Why do you say that?
In some ways, the waking up is a side effect of enlightenment. If you wake up from the fact that we inhabit a series of systems that we can in some ways worship these systems as though they were false gods, once you realize that, that is the enlightenment. So it's not, Gnosticism has never been, okay, if you say this prayer, if you subscribe to this particular creedal model, if you bow in this direction at this time of day, that you'll be saved. Gnosticism has never been a set of tools or a toolkit to attain enlightenment. Gnosticism has been a specifically cultural reaction to the gnosis, to the insight of individuals who then, having attained this gnosis, went and said, how can I explain this to people? What tools can I give people so that when it happens to them, they've got a place to plant it? Gnosis itself is not the ultimate liberation. In fact, even when you see the models about how Gnosis is explained within, not only within the Hamadi documentation, but with what the Christian world did with it, what the pre-Christian world did with it, it's a step on the path. And that ultimate space is described as either grace or complete liberation. I think that a much better translation for Gnosis, other than enlightenment, is what Dr. Elaine Pagels refers to. She says insight. And I think when you have that insight, you are liberated from the from being underneath the system. You are aware that you're in one. And now it's a question of, Tagirat, what are you going to do about it? When we look back at these Alexandrian Jews 2,200 years ago, having had these flashes of insight from different in the context of different cultures, so okay, what's a way that we can take all of our experiences and make a predominant myth and a symbol set and a mythical language so that when you have this gnosis, which is really just a seed, we have a place to plant it and to nurture it and to let it grow. So it's really critical to acknowledge, and I think that everybody's been pretty good about this reality, is that Gnosticism does not have the market cornered on Gnosis. Gnosis is a universal experience that happens within and without any religion. You do not need to be a Gnostic in order to have Gnosis. Once you have Gnosis, if you're in culture X, and you're trying to figure out what you're going to do with it, some cultures certainly are more receptive to Gnosis than others. If you are a Muslim and you have flashes of Gnosis, you have the Sufi traditions, for example, on which to draw, and a place for your Gnosis to reside and to be celebrated and to become amplified. Gnosticism is one of those cultures or one of those nests in which to create a safe space for Gnosis to happen. The difference between a lot of other traditions and Gnosticism is that Gnosticism was specifically crafted by people who already had Gnosis. It was not a secondhand thing. It wasn't like, okay, we have a teacher who's over here, and then the teacher dies, and then his successors try to figure out what he was talking about, and that the successors build a superstructure around what their assumptions were about the teacher, and they say, if you follow this, then eventually it'll create some sort of funnel, and you'll find your enlightenment there. Gnosticism has never taken that tack. It simply said, having already got these little flashes, which are perfectly natural and perfectly universal, what's a way that we can explain and celebrate and amplify this process? And here is one way. And the way that these guys created and was really revolving around the Sophianic myth and the creation myth, the sort of emanations, cosmogony, that we see in things like the Secret Book of John, that we see reflected in Pistis Sophia and a lot of these other materials.
And Jordan, despite its small membership, why do you think Gnosticism is such an allure for our modern culture? It just keeps, it just won't go away.
There are so few people who will stand up and say, I'm a Gnostic, and who will really identify with this specific cultural interpretation of what, is a universal human process. And yet, you can't open a news magazine without seeing some kind of reference to Gnosticism to a Gnostic Gospel of Judas, for example, or trying to find some kind of Gnostic tie-in with something like the James Ossuary or the Jesus tomb, none of which has anything to do with Gnosticism whatsoever. And most commonly it's used as a pejorative. There's certainly an archetype that Western culture, particularly Puritan-influenced North American culture, has about forbidden fruit. And that's why on the cover of my book I have Eve offering the reader the apple. The apple of Gnosis.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And, the big difference is that in the Christian worldview, Eve taking the apple and partaking of it and then offering it, that this was essentially a bad thing. This was the fall of humanity. And our take is quite the inverse of that, saying that when Eve takes of the apple, that's the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, that she incorporates that gnosis into herself, then seeing that the world that she inhabits was without gnosis, the first thing that she wanted to do as an act of compassion, as an act of love, is to offer it to her husband, and then liberates him. So Eve is the first human Gnostic saint. There's that a recurring archetype of forbidden fruit, that within, we're so carved out of a block of these stories of the Garden of Eden and many, many other myths, but specifically when we're talking about our origins and our roots, well, we get back to the garden, and there's some idea of this loss of innocence, and there is another theme which draws out of that, which is the North American fixation on childhood, and about how we tend to enthrone childhood, we enthrone innocence, that we have a childhood which is three times longer than any other cultural childhood on the planet, because somehow this idea of maturation, of responsibility, of adulthood is something that is evil or sinful or to be avoided. You know, and quite honestly, that's not particularly healthy psychologically. Gnosticism has always said that maturation, individuation, you know, growing the hell up and getting to work is what we're here for. It's what we're supposed to be doing, as opposed to idolizing a state of being in the garden, being perfectly innocent, having our eyes closed, that's how we were supposed to reject the fruit of gnosis when it was offered to us.
Yeah, and also I couldn't believe when you wrote this little fact that most people don't know, how Pope Benedict mentioned that Gnosticism was the single greatest threat to Orthodoxy. I was like, whoa, they're on to us.
Well, I think to be fair to His Holiness, that I doubt very much that he's even aware of us. I mean, I don't think that he's sitting there in the Vatican checking the palm tree garden every hour.
Yes, he is. You know he is. No?
So, you know, I don't think that he's really talking about Gnosticism, you know, sort of a capital G Gnosticism as an authentic, thriving religious culture that has survived almost parasitically throughout Christian history in the West. You know, I think that he's talking about the conflict between personal experience and faith, between that sense of personal responsibility versus a collective responsibility. And, you know, I can see if you're in the social engineering business, if you're in the bulk business, where you've got a creedal dynamic, if you sign here, everything will be fine, that this can't be opposed any more clearly than something that says, you know, even once you have this creed, this isn't going to do you any good unless you work it out for yourself as an adult. Those are opposing ideas. That doesn't necessarily mean that they can't be reconciled, but, you know, the opening position of both of those are antithetical to one another. Now, I happen to know that there are a whole lot of Catholic Gnostics, there are a whole lot of Orthodox Gnostics, there are a whole lot of Jewish Gnostics, who are perfectly capable in reconciling those two positions within themselves. But I'm not going to pretend that's not a hell of a lot of work. So,
oh,
from an opening standpoint, what is it that saves us? What are we being saved from? The Orthodox position of Pope Benedict is that we're being saved from sin, we're being saved from eternal torment by faith. And that this faith is a gift of divine grace. I mean, I could talk about the Catholic position of salvation and soteriology for several days and barely scratch the surface, because it's a very complicated idea, and I'd just be doing it injustice to summarizing it. That being said, within the Gnostic position, we say, regardless of the faith that you do have, I think that faith does have a role. I mean, faith certainly has a role for many individual Gnostics within their own practice and within their own religion. In terms of salvation, as a concept in Gnosticism, we repeat to the theme that, well, you're saved from ignorance by knowledge. There's not a whole lot of eternal torment and rending garments and gnashing of teeth within Gnostic mythology. You know, the problem when we talk about darkness or we talk about death, these are really references to ignorance. You know, what is death if not ignorance? That's Sylvanus. So if you're just sleepwalking, if you're just accepting the way of the world, we're also participating through your own submission to this way of the world, to Rex Mundi. You know, St. Paul goes at tremendous length within the Pauline letters to say, this is really not a very good idea. So, you know, Gnosticism and Christianity are not necessarily opposed in this regard. We just put the emphasis on saying, you know, the first thing you need to do is accept some responsibility. That's your ability to respond. You have it. And we have all these wonderful gifts with which to liberate ourselves to ask these questions. We have our culture. We have a cultural legacy. We have our intuition. We have our intellect. We have our compassion. And this is the crowbar, and we're trying to organize a prison break. And the prison that we're trying to liberate ourselves from is one of complacency, of ignorance, of the status quo that can, as we know so well, be used as a mechanism for injustice, for oppression, not just of ourselves and of our own spiritual being, but of course of our own, you know, from our own culture and from our own species and ultimately for our planet. So, you know, we have all of these gifts. Not using these gifts is a shame. And there's definitely an intellectual slant to it. I think that belies the fact that, that it reveals the fact that Gnosticism really grew out of philosophical circles. You know, you had to have a way with words in order to attack this stuff. If you're going to be showing up in cafe society, you got to do more than just, you know, drink espresso all day. you know, the hotshots were the poets and were those who spoke well and presented their ideas well, which I think gave some degree of credence to Gnostic elitism. That doesn't mean a spiritual elitism. It does mean that the people who were doing the heavy lifting within Gnostic culture, within Gnostic literature, were the people who could write. And that automatically gives you a degree of cultural elitism.
Okay, Jordan, why don't we move on to some of the practices of Gnosticism, or the view of Gnosticism. How does mindfulness work in Gnosticism? When you write about it, is it the same concept of mindfulness you find in Buddhism, or what are the little differences?
To my mind, no pun intended, I think that every mystical tradition, and Gnosticism is definitely a mystical tradition, has an approach and has as its center a sense of responsibility around the way that we think, the way that we envision, the way that we put our ideas together in our head, and how those impact the world around us. I'm not aware of any religious tradition with any kind of roots to it that doesn't have a mandatory time in silence. Whether you're talking about the three big religions of the West, or whether you're talking about Buddhism or Hinduism or Zoroastrianism, there's always a time that you need to unplug and just sit in silence. And out of that silence comes the stilling of the mind, and as you bring that still mind into your daily interaction, you're needing to be aware of the tools that we use to visualize the world and to express the world. So this question of right speech and right thought impacts things like right livelihood. So, and I use that language because, ironically enough, more people in the West are familiar with the Buddhist language than they are with the original Greek philosophical language that it reflects. So for all intents and purposes, to make a long story short, even though I just made it fairly long, I don't see a difference between Buddhist mindfulness and Gnostic mindfulness and Christian mindfulness. I think we just need to pay attention.
And how does the practice of prayer of a Gnostic differ from that of a traditional Christian?
Well, you know, I think that it's one of those many... I'm going to spend a lot of time in this interview, I think, apologizing for generalizing something as complex as Christianity. I don't think that the flaw is... in Christianity itself. I think the problem is with Christian religious education. So culturally, we have this religious education that says prayer is essentially like writing a letter to Santa Claus. You say, "Dear Santa, I've been really good. I want a pony. And here I've got you some milk and cookies." So it's definitely a bribery negotiation. It's, "I'll do this if you do that." And that's certainly not the prayer of the saints. It's certainly, you know, we got a pretty good idea that Aquinas and Augustine were not praying that way. But that becomes sort of the default position of prayer because of religious education. So a prayer within Gnosticism starts from that space of mindfulness that says, we know who we are. And I think that when we talk about Gnosticism, I'd like to sort of return to the core themes, because I do classify Gnosticism in the book as a literary genre, which I think is probably the easiest way to understand it. That in Gnostic prayer, we say, I know who I am. I am an aspect of the infinite divine. I am a spark of God. And what I'm trying to do is burn away the debris which is within my own understanding of that, and the things which I allow to impede my responsibility to that. So while there is a degree of aggrandizement, if you will, within Gnosticism, sure, you're God, okay. we're all God. Gosh, doesn't that make me sound special? As soon as you do realize that we are aspects of God, that we are sparks of the infinite divine, this gives you a tremendous amount of work to do. You know, we're the spiritual janitors of the planet, and the place is a mess. So you know, we can't simply be humble servants. We can't be, you know, we're lowly worms down here, and you're the big boss up there. Because really what that says is, I don't have any power, I can't respond to anything, I don't have any responsibility. And it's that kind of slacking that Gnosticism absolutely negates and vaporizes it. So prayer then says, okay, what tools do I have at my disposal that I can get to work? And sometimes the tool is a relationship. Sometimes it's being a lover. Sometimes it's being a parent. Or a teacher. Sometimes it's simply sitting in solitude. Sometimes it's painting. You know, there's a very strong artistic impulse that's always expressed itself through Gnosticism, particularly in the Gnostic Renaissance within the Restoration in the 19th century. In the early 19th century, the people who were glomming onto Gnosticism were artists and poets and dancers and early photographers and cinematographers. So there's a very strong sense of symbolic expression that's associated with the experience of Gnosticism, and particularly when you're trying to, as I said before, amplify and celebrate it.
And Jordan, do you have any other simple Gnostic practices that can help an individual on their day-to-day lives?
I would certainly say that the first thing to do is, you know, from any tradition, I'm a big fan of the John Dillinger School of Enlightenment. And John Dillinger, during his bank robberies, used to say, lie down on the floor and remain calm. I can't think of any better advice for daily spiritual practice than that. So, you know, make sure you're in a bank holdup, and that's, you'll be a guru in no time. So commit to taking some time to just sit in silence. And maybe it's, you know, after you've fed the cat and done the dishes and put your kids to bed and whatever, just take that 4 or 5 minutes to just sit in silence and just hear yourself, and then just to hear nothing. So silence is really critical. And an evaluation of your day, or reflection, is saying, When today did I lose my cool? When today was I not treating myself with respect? When was I treating the earth with respect? When was I treating my neighbor with respect? And then we have sort of the platinum rule, where within the Christian tradition, that it's not love God and then, you know, love your neighbor. It's, hey, loving God is loving your neighbor, and loving your neighbor is loving God. I mean, it's that the fusion of those ideas is so radical. And we can certainly learn from that example. On a regular basis, we have there's the individual practice of Lectio Divina, which is simply a divine reading. Look at a scrap of Gnostic scripture. There's a ton in my book that are just little fortune cookie-sized bits to think about. And you can go read this in different states. One is just to read the words and read them out loud and let them fill up your body. And to read them with a poetic voice. Try to give it some more timbre, actually. Think about how you're breathing and how the shape of your mouth forms the words as they come out. And then to just sit and to intellectually examine What do these words mean? What's the context? Why this choice of words, not that choice of words? And how can I make this thing mean the opposite? And to do an intellectual analysis. And then to go a little deeper, and then just to kind of surrender to it and say, to invite the meaning of the words to come despite the words or without the words. Just invite the meaning of that particular passage to enter into the sacred space that you create. And then finally, just let the whole thing go. Just sit with the message of those words, just in a state of just simple coexistence, just a simple detachment. You just occupy the same space as that message. And that's something that can be done, you know, in 10 or 15 minutes. You can do it every day. You can do it once a week. You can do it on special occasions. You can do it by yourself. You can do it with others. This is, very accessible. And it's really a practice of centering prayer. I would go on the internet and just Google centering prayer. There's a lot of great information about it. It's a very common technique. And it's just about sitting in silence. But within the last 200 years, we've specifically seen a return to, within Gnosticism as a religion, we've seen a specific return to a sacramental practice that we see so well expressed within the Valentinian Gnostics. And in the Gospel of Philip, we identify the five sacraments that were celebrated by that community at the time. We see a reference to the Philippine sacraments within Thomas. The five trees that are referred to in Thomas are a reflection of the five sacraments that are in Philip. In the modern era, within the last 100 years, as we've seen through the independent sacramental movement, we've seen liberal Catholics and independent Catholics embrace Gnosticism and give a validity in that specific legalistic sense to Gnostic sacraments, which my church, the Apostolic Johannine Church, has enjoyed since the beginning of the 19th century through a bishop named Noviel, but that's a whole other thing. We're back to dead Gnostics again, and I can wonder about that. For the majority of ecclesiastical Gnostics in the world today, we practice the same seven sacraments as the Roman Catholic Church. But we do this with a different understanding, with an esoteric or an alchemical understanding. So there's a love of the history and of the poetry, of the ritualism, but our interpretation, our take on it is quite different. In some ways, it reflects more of a Renaissance Neoplatonism. In some ways, actually, I would say in a lot of ways, it's been very, very influenced by the work of Jung. There's such a huge overlap between Jung's exploration and the understanding, the contemporary understanding of Gnosticism. I think we can't underemphasize, we shouldn't underemphasize the contribution that Bishop Stefan Heller's made in that regard. I think that he has really dragged a lot of Gnostics to the Jungian fold and vice versa. And because it's such a natural fit. And likewise, I think that Philip K. Dick's contribution can't be overlooked in any way. A lot of people have found themes within Dick's material that have brought them to identifying themselves as Gnostics. While I would say that, there are lots and lots and lots of Gnostics who will never, ever step into a Gnostic church and never meet another Gnostic and certainly never partake in a Gnostic sacrament, the majority of Gnosticism as a contemporary religious movement is happening with churches, with clergy, and with sacraments that appear superficially to be very, very Catholic, although their interpretation philosophically is much closer to Buddhism, and their intellectual interpretation is much closer to both Christian mysticism and Christian mystical traditions, other mystical traditions, Jungian interpretation, and particularly alchemy, which I explore briefly in my book.
And Jordan, could you tell us the four principal characteristics of early Gnostic texts that you write in your book, Living Gnosticism?
Yeah, this was a really interesting and collaborative approach done with a whole bunch of people, most notably through Jesse Folks in Maryland and Jeremy Puma in Seattle, kicking around first off a rejection of the cliches about Gnosticism, which we identified at the beginning of our conversation today. And the result of the any kind of textual analysis in light of the Gnostic cliche falls apart very quickly. And that's why you have people like Dr. Meyer saying, you know, we should really stop using the term Gnosticism altogether. And you see King and Williams and these other scholars are experimenting with the idea of maybe we shouldn't just talk about Gnosticism because the cliche doesn't add up, which is kind of throwing the baby out with the bathwater, as Dr. Bart Ehrman agrees and says, if we stop using the term Gnosticism, nobody's going to know what we're really talking about. The job somehow came to a bunch of lay people and armchair scholars and Gnostic clerics to do a pretty rigorous textual analysis of the Nag Hammadi library, as well as other things which are often associated with Gnosticism, such as the Corpus Hermeticum. And every time that something comes up, we write it down. If they're talking about salvation or a mechanism of salvation or a particular ritual or a particular character, such as Sophia or the Demiurge or the personage Seth, and we write all that down. And then you go on to the next scripture, and kind of compile a list and say, well, what are the commonalities? The commonality that's been identified by the academic circles is the Demiurge, which is the half-creator or the sort of the by-proxy creator who is not the ultimate god, but who creates, or that is to say, actually doesn't create anything ever, but he organizes the system in which we inhabit. And this is oppositional to the Gnostic's best interest in which we're trying to escape the system or we oppose the Demiurge. The problem with that as a default theme is that there are not enough Gnostic texts to even bring him up. I mean, the Demiurge does not exist in the large majority of Gnostic texts. So we can't be about him. You know, what is it about? And we ended up dealing ultimately with four recurring themes that to which at least 80% of the Nag Hammadi library corresponds. And the first one is that it's gnosis, not faith, that saves us from deception. So that the soteriology, our salvation, is about gnosis. Gnosis matters. You have to have the insight before you can get started. That's number one. The second is the model of emanations, which is a flowing out of God. If you drop a pebble in the water, ripples emanate. They flow out of that one initial stone-dropping event. When Gnosticism talks about the system and the world and the universe and the everythingness, the pleroma, the fullness, this metaphor of emanation, of flowing out, is a recurring theme. And you know, the really interesting thing about that is that this takes that whole dualistic model of Gnostics rejecting the earth or hating the flesh or somehow being radically dualist. This evaporates in the sense in the face of emanations, which we see ubiquitously throughout Gnostic texts. And because how do you separate one ripple from the ripple that precedes it? How do you separate any of those ripples from the suspension medium, from the water in which those ripples are evident? How do you separate this from the stone-dropping event? So there is this monism. Admittedly, it's a monism which is opposed to the artificial constructs that get bolted on top of it, but there is a monism. There is a totality. There is a pleroma. And the theme of this pleroma is everywhere within Gnostic texts. So we're all part of the whole shebang. The third issue is what we can call an immanent pneumatology, which is to say that the spirit, the pneuma, is everywhere. And obviously the most common and oft-stated bit out of Thomas is, lift up stone and I'm there, split a piece of wood and you'll find me there. That inside of absolutely everything is a little spark of the divine, and we are part of that. I think that gives us a tremendous responsibility, particularly from an environmental standpoint, from a universal standpoint of looking at not just rocks and trees and flowers and saying that, you know, we're part of that, but also looking at each other and saying, you know, that everybody that you meet on the street is a spark of the infinite divine. There's a quality, there's a degree of respect there that suddenly enters that conversation, and I think brings with it an incredible social imperative, as well as an environmental imperative. And the fourth is that we connect with this sacredness, with that spark, through a sacramental theology, that we've always had mysteries of the baptism, the Eucharist, and you know, the ritual of the bridal chamber, that we've always had these ways of expressing and celebrating the cycles of life and death, of love, and doing that in a very deliberate way, and doing that often in a very communal way. So we have these four themes: that gnosis matters, that everything is part of God, that we are all sparks of the divine, and that that spark is everywhere and that it wants to be known, as well as the fact that we have this poetry, we have this art, and we have this beauty for celebrating our connection and the cycles of our connection. And that seems to be everywhere. You know, looking at, you sort of pick something out of the Nag Hammadi Library or the Gnostic Coptic Library at random and look how it associates to these four themes. We keep coming back to these issues. So when we look at Gnosticism, it's never been a monolithic, organized movement. It's never had a canon. It's never had a, you know, okay, this gets to be Gnostic, but this doesn't. And I think that Dr. Heller said it best when he said that identifying Gnosticism is like having a musical ear. And it's a wonderful phrase, which I steal all the time. Because you know, there is definitely an aesthetic vibe to it that you ultimately become attuned to. And that if we view the Gnostic authors as composers, they keep returning to these themes. I use the metaphor of a literary genre, and I think that if we use the language of literary criticism, that a lot of things are going to come to light as Gnostic that don't necessarily have a historic continuity or even an immediate cultural continuity with what we've identified previously as Gnostic. But if we say there are a set of themes, and the reason why these themes exist is because they are archetypal. They exist within the way that our intelligence grasps our reality, that grasps our situation, and as a response we have these archetypal tools. Those archetypal tools in turn create different responses, which are explorations of these themes. You know, there's a real specific informational mechanism in place here that gives us a new model for using this, using the big G word. And I think that gets us out of the tangle of talking or trying to make things conform to the demiurge or trying to conform to heresiological, which is the heresy hunter's definition of Gnosticism. And I think we need to get out from under that.
I think that's all the time we have today, Jordan. So okay. I'd like to thank you again for coming on Coffee, Cigarettes, and Gnosis. As always, it's an honor and a delight listening to your sapience.
This is always a blast. Much fun.
Likewise. Lots to think about. Anyway, try to stay warm while you can, and we will have you on soon, and good luck with your book.
Thank you very much. It's always great to be here.
All right. Take care.
My blessing.